Subdeep modeling is a modeling workflow where you optimize your models to be used easily with the subdivision surface modifier. Subd is short for subdivision surface. For example, this model on the left here is just a basic cylinder, whereas on the right, I have a cylinder optimized for subd. But before I show you how to do this, you might be wondering why you would want to do subd modeling in the first place. Subd modeling is used a lot in 3D fields, such as product visualization, VFX, or any kind of project where having high detail is important. Subd modeling is good for these kind of projects, since they can have the level of detail adjusted easily using this subdivision surface modifier. Notice how when I lower the modifier, we got less detail, and as I increase this number, we get a much more higher resolution result, which could be great for doing close-up shots, for example, in an animation. Can I use this kind of modeling for games though? For the most part, the models you make with this may sometimes be a little bit too high poly for games, but you could model using the Subd modeling workflow, duplicate your object, and then optimize that model for a game engine by removing unnecessary geometry, as game models should have the least amount of geometry whilst preserving the loop you're going for, since they work in real-time engines, and we don't have 5 hours to render each frame. You can also bake detail from your Subd model onto your game optimized model to bring some of that detail back, so game artists still have a lot to gain from learning Subd modeling. Let's go ahead and cover some of the basics using a cylinder. To add an object in Blender, I'm just going to hold down the Shift key, and I'm going to keep it held, and then I'm just going to press the A key as well, and this will bring up the Add menu. Under Mesh here, you can see I've got a few different primitive objects, and I'm just going to choose Cylinder. You'll notice we have a bit of jagginess around here, and to fix that, all we need to do is right-click and choose Shade Alt Smooth. Right now, to see our geometry, we can press Tab to go into Edit Mode, and you can see this is the default cylinder we've been given. I'm now going to show you what happens when we add a subdivision surface modifier to this. So I'm going to come to this blue spanner here called Modifier Properties. I'll left click Add Modifier, and then under Generate, I'm going to choose Subdivision Surface. You will notice it creates a heck of a mess, and this is why it's important to optimize models for the subdivision surface. You notice even if I increase the levels viewport here, we're just getting an even more sophisticated mess. So why does this happen? First of all, for Subd modeling, we need to be working in quads, so let's go and have a look. So I'll press Tab to go into Edit Mode, and if I press 3 on the keyboard to go into Face Select Mode, you can see we've got some rectangular faces here, and these would be considered quads because they're made up of just 4 edges per face. If anything has any more edges than 4, it's considered an N-gon. And if anything has 3 edges, it's considered a tri. As I mentioned, for using the subdivision surface modifier most effectively in Blender, we need to work in quads. And you can see on the top here, we have a massive N-gon made up of way more than 4 edges, which is creating this strange issue. Thankfully, to turn this into quads isn't too difficult. The first thing we can do, which will create a massive improvement straight away, is I can left click this top face and press I. If you followed my 3D modeling course, you will know that I is the inset tool, which allows us to create a face within a face. You'll notice as I've added this face, it's also doing something else, but I'm going to talk about that a little bit later. For now, let's just focus on making everything out of quads. While we've managed to create some quads here, and it seems to have softened the issue a little bit, we still have a massive N-gon in the middle. So if I wanted to get rid of this, all we need to do is press X, and then just choose Delete Faces. You can see that's removed that face, but how are we going to fill this in with quads? Thankfully, Blender has a really handy tool to do this. I'm going to press 2 on the keyboard, which is going to take me into Edge Select Mode, and if I hold down the Alt key and then left click, you can see that selects that entire circle of edges. Then I'm going to come up to the top here, where we have all these options, and when I left click Face, then here, I'm just going to choose Grid Fill. And you can see that that's filled in this circle all with quads, so every single one of these faces is made up of just 4 edges each. If you want to keep everything nice and aligned, like I did in my example at the start of the video, you can use this Offset parameter to spin this circle of quads around. So I can left click one of the arrows here, and you can notice it's gonna start moving it around. And now I've got it nice and aligned like that. Now let's go ahead and do the bottom as well. So I'll press 3 on the keyboard again, left click this face, press I to inset. Then with this face still selected, I can press the X key to open up the delete menu, left click faces, press 2 on the keyboard to go into edge select mode. And then if I hold down the Alt key and left click, this edge loop here is gonna select all those edges. Then I can press face, and then choose Grid Fill. And again, I'm just going to use this offset. I think a number of 4 makes it nice and even. Oh no, maybe 3 is better. There we go. If I press Tab to come back into Object Mode, you can see we've gotten rid of all those weird deformations, and it's created this kind of barrel shape. So we've solved that first problem of making sure everything is now working in quads. What that pretty much means is when we increase our subdivision surface modifier, it's not going to be subdividing in a weird way and creating some issues for us. It's going to be subdividing as we would hope it to. But then if you're wanting a cylinder, you might be thinking, well, this isn't really what I'm wanting. You might also be wondering though, why is it quads that the subdivision surface works best in? Well, quads are very easy to subdivide. They also cause less shading issues and work best with curved surfaces, making it perfect for this modeling workflow. Quads are also great for using a lot of Blender's modeling hotkeys. For example, if I press Tab to go into Edit Mode, press 3 to go into Face Select Mode, and press Alt Left Click, you can see I can select all of these faces in a ring. But if these were all n-gons and triangles, we wouldn't be able to use that hotkey. So quads are essential for modeling in general inside of Blender. To make this kind of barrel shape more cylindrical, we're going to need the next ingredient in the sub-D modeling workflow. This is called holding edges or supporting loops. These terms both refer to the same process of adding an edge loop closer to another edge loop in order to tell the subdivision surface algorithm to make that transition a lot sharper. There are loads of different ways to add supporting loops. One easy way is to use the add loop tool in Blender. So if I hold down Control and then press R, you can see that that's going to give me the option here where I hover over my face loops here. It's going to tell me to create an edge loop. You'll notice I'm in face select mode right now, but when I left click to put this loop cut in place, it will automatically turn to edge select mode for us, which is really handy. Now you'll notice if I drag this loop around, it's going to start affecting the subdivision surface modifier. I'm going to pull it all the way up to the top here, and you can see it's going to start making that sharper. So what exactly is happening here? Well, the way the subdivision surface modifier works, or at least the Catmull-Clark version, is it calculates the smoothing based on the distance between each of these rings of edges. For example, if I press Ctrl R again and add a loop cut here and pull this really close and then press Tab to come back into object mode, you can see it's creating a bit of sharpness here. With that loop still selected, I can just press Ctrl X to dissolve it. Now it's looking a little bit more cylindrical at the top here, but there's still a bit of a curvedness to it. So to fix that, we can go ahead and add another edge loop, but on the top surface this time to even it out. So I'm going to press Ctrl R again, and then here I can just left click and drag this closer. Now you can see that's creating a nice smooth transition. And sometimes for the sub-D workflow, it kind of helps to turn off this shade smooth by angle modifier, which is caused by right clicking and pressing shade alt smooth. So I'm just going to press the X here to remove it. And now when I increase my subdivision surface modifier, you can see that's creating a nice edge on the top of our cylinder. As I mentioned though, there's a few other ways to add supporting loops. One other way is using the inset tool, which we used earlier. So if I press 3 on the keyboard and then press alt left click to select these loops, I can press I, and you'll notice that that's going to now create faces within that, and that's hardened off this bottom bit here. I'm going to press Ctrl Z to undo that because I'm going to show you another technique. The most important thing to understand about supporting loops and holding edges is that we're just bringing edges close to each other in order to tell the subdivision surface modifier to make the surface sharper in that area. I would say though the best way to do this is using the bevel tool. So I'm going to press 2 on the keyboard to go into edge select mode, and if I press alt left click on this edge here to select this loop, I want to make this edge here hard so it's like a cylinder on the top and the bottom. To access the bevel command, we can just hold down Control and press B, and you'll notice that that's now going to create a bevel. This is a start, but you can see it's still a little bit curved and we want it to be hardened off so it doesn't create too much of a smooth transition. To do that is very simple. You can see in the left hand corner I've got this bevel menu. If I left click it to open it, I'm going to keep my segments at 2 and I'm going to change my shape here, or factor as it's called in older versions, to 1. You can see that's hardened it off like that. You can also make this a little bit sharper by decreasing the width to something maybe more like this. Now when I press Tab to go back into object mode, you can see we have a nice hard edge on the bottom of our cylinder and on the top as well. Awesome, so that's the basics of how this subdivision surface workflow works. Let's try this on a cube as well. So I'm going to press Shift A again, then under mesh I'm going to left click cube. To move this cube to the right here, I'm just going to use some hotkeys. So I can press the G key, which is the grab key, and that's going to allow me to move my cube around. Then if I want to move it just right, I'm going to want to move it along the Y axis, which as you can see in the top right hand corner of my viewport, is that green line. So I'll press Y after pressing G, and that's going to then lock my grabbing to this Y axis. Now I'll just move this along to here, and then left click to save its position. Let's go ahead and add a subdivision surface modifier. So I'll come to Add Modifier, and under Generate, you can choose Subdivision Surface. If you're pretty comfortable with adding this modifier, you can use this hotkey as well, where you hold down the Control key and then press the number 1 or 2 to add a subdivision surface modifier. Notice if I press the number 1, the levels viewport will be set to 1, but if I choose 2, the viewport will be set to 2. I'm going to set it up to 2 manually, and you can see that it's turning our cube into more of a sphere. This is pretty normal behavior for this modifier, and to fix this, all we're going to need to do is use that bevel trick to add some holding edges or support loops. So I'm going to press Tab to go into edit mode, and I'm just going to press A to make sure I've got everything selected. So think of it as A to select all. Then I can go ahead and hold down the Control key and press B. And now you'll notice it's kept the settings we had earlier, but I can just left click and drag it till I'm happy. Obviously, the bigger I make this, the more smooth our cube is going to be. So I'm maybe going to pull it down to a nice sharp surface like this, and I'll left click it to save it. Then in your bevel menu here, just make sure your shape is set to 1 and your segments are set to 2, and you should be good to go. I'll press Tab to come back into object mode, and to remove this jaggedness here, you can just right click and choose Shade Smooth. And now we have a nice smoothed cube, which is working with the subdivision surface modifier. And I can increase the detail if I was doing a close-up, for example, just by increasing the subdivision surface levels viewport.
lot.
So as you can see, subdivision surface modeling is fairly simple once you understand the basics. If you want to learn more about sub-D modeling, make sure to check out this playlist here, which will be having videos added to it regularly to keep improving your sub-D modeling skills. Apart from that though, I'd like to thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next video. Take care.